Welcome to the Fruity Knitting Podcast. We're at episode 10 already, and I'm Andrea.
I'm Andrew.
So today, in this episode, we are going to go to the UK, into Yorkshire in particular, and we're going to get very close with some Hebridean sheep, and we'll find out about conservation grazing. You will also have an opportunity to find out how your knitting could help the Yorkshire wildlife. So, what else are we featuring? We're featuring our Knitters of the World segment, and that's going to be a personal friend of mine who I'm very proud and happy to show.
We've got an update on our KALs and some exciting news there, I think. A fun idea that's coming into that. And we're also going to find out about my entry to the KAL.
Yes, Andrew's design, his hiking jacket design.
Yep.
So that's all coming up. So we normally go straight into Bring and Brag, and Bring and Brag is the section where we show our finished knitted objects. But this week we have nothing to bring along and brag about, so we're moving finished. Straight into under construction.
Yep.
So I was... you would like to start?
I want to go first.
Okay.
Yeah, these are my socks. They're almost identical to what they were in the last episode. I've been doing research and preparing for my my own project, my KAL project. So I'll get some work done on it now, and Andrea, we can hand over to you.
Okay. So last episode I showed you Marie Wallen's Springtime book in a lot of detail and went through and described the technical aspects of most of the patterns in here. And I'm knitting the garment on the front cover, which is a cardigan for in between seasons. It comes down with sleeves to about the bracelet length.
You can call them bracelet sleeves, can't you?
Yes, you can, if you want to be sophisticated.
Yeah.
So this one is, here's another picture of it here, but I'll put a picture over Andrew right now. So it is a combination of Fair Isle and Intarsia. And I've been moving along reasonably well on it. I'll show you my progress. I can't quite remember what I showed you last episode, but here is the back finished. And perhaps, Andrew, you might like to hold it for me.
Very well.
Thank you. So you just hold this side here, and I'll hold this side.
Right.
So, as you can see, that's the back panel. And we've got this lovely strip of Fair Isle down the bottom, which is a leafy pattern, and the garment is done in pieces, which means you have to purl Fair Isle, which a lot of people find pretty scary, and I did it first too, but this is a very doable garment because you've only got small sections to have to go back and forward and purl. If I turn it around, you'll see. So you can see there are my that's the back side, and I use the two-handed Fair Isle technique that we talked about in one of the episodes when we interviewed the philosopher's wool, Eugene and
Bourgeois.
But they taught me all the techniques for that. I don't think I learned how to purl and Fair Isle for them, but I just adapted what I learned from them to suit the purling. And so, as you can see, it's a very woven. I don't have long floats at all, which I love because you'd never get anything caught in it. So I am going to do a tutorial showing you how to purl in Fair Isle. So that is how to weave in the floats on both hands. So the floats from the yarn on the right hand, the floats from the yarn on the left hand, and to weave in your new wool as you use it and weave out your ends. So you never have a whole lot of ends to weave in at the end of a project. You simply get your scissors and chop them off. Okay, so that's the back section. And I've done a sleeve, which is a set-in sleeve. So would you mind holding again? And that has, again, this, I'll open it up for you first, but it has this lovely patterned, leafy pattern border, and so it's going to sit about there on the arm. So that's the back done, one sleeve done, and this is one of the front panels, so the right front panel, and so So we've got the continuation of the leafy border, which is done in Fair Isle, and then this motif here, which is a little bit Eastern European looking, and that is described as being done as in Tarsia, but I actually do it in a form of Fair Isle. So, but it's really beautiful. I love the pattern. I think it's incredibly elegant. I can't wait to wear it. So this is going to be mirrored on the other side, and as I've showed you, the back is plain. So it's really quite a doable project. You've only got small amounts of difficulty, really.
Yep.
So the back of this, if you don't mind still holding it up, is the same. Okay, so I start here and then I Fair Isle, can you hold that there? I Fair Isle the green and the white across for where, and the section only that I need it. And on the side sections, I just continue on in the background colour. So I will show you how to do that in a tutorial. Now, I assume that anyone who wants to knit this has probably already knitted a garment, so they don't need to see everything. I don't need to do a tutorial on absolutely everything. So I will just do it on these techniques, and possibly also how I seam up and insert a set-in sleeve, because it seems that a lot of people like to avoid doing that. I find it so easy. I backstitch everything. I totally backstitch everything, and I love it. I never have a problem with it. I don't find it bulky. It's incredibly easy. I find it easier than mattress stitch, because it's harder to line up two pieces of fabric like this and pin them than it is to line them up like this. So you can line them very exactly together and then backstitch along. So I would perhaps also show you that, because that kind of technique you can apply to any garment. Yeah, and so here I have the left side panel to finish, and that's the bottom of the second sleeve done. Hopefully I'll finish it by episode 11 and have it in the bring and brag.
Hopefully.
Yes.
I thought you were committed.
I'm committed. I'll definitely finish it by then. Okay. I was just giving myself a little bit of leeway so I don't have to go back on my word.
Bit of wriggle room.
So we're moving on.
Yep.
Okay, so we're going to get straight on to our KALs news. And I haven't spoken about our KALs for a couple of episodes now. So just to briefly tell you again, I'm running a Fair Isle KALs. So that is for adult size garments of Fair Isle. So a garment is in a jumper, a cardigan or a vest, or a large shawl. So that's all, they're all valid garments to be entered.
Yep, allowed.
Allowed.
And my KALs, where I don't say I'm running it, I'm just the mascot, is for a first garment KALs. So if you're making your first garment, then you can join this KALs and present your work there. The rules are essentially it has to be an adult garment and it has to have sleeves. So it's a bit of a challenge, but that's kind of the point of the KALs, is to help each other along. And we did have this, what we think is a really cool idea. You can talk about the dates maybe.
So our KALs, I made the KALs very long, both KALs very long. So to encourage people to take time to plan their project, to take time picking their yarn, picking their pattern, and to do it in an easy pace, especially if you've never done Fair Isle before. And my KALs is definitely for both first-time Fair Isle knitters and very experienced Fair Isle knitters. That it's great for you to enter as well, because then you get to show your amazing work to inspire others.
Yeah, and I saw people are having good tips on there too.
Yes, it's
some
great.
Of the questions around Fair Isle knitting.
There's some wonderful projects. All of the projects that have been entered are wonderful. They're beautiful choices of yarn and patterns. I love to see it. I haven't been very active, but I certainly read everything. I read everything and look at everything, but because I'm working quite hard and preparing for this as well, I don't have time to respond. But other people have been giving advice and swapping information around, and that's wonderful. So thank you so much for doing that. And thank you for sharing your photos. Keep sharing them. Keep taking photos of your progress. And I also wanted to say, so it started at the beginning of July and it goes to the end of October. So there's a lot of time. We've still got 3 more months. So come and keep, you know, come in.
Yeah.
Come in with, if you're still considering, or this is the first time you're viewing us and you're inspired to do so, we would love to have you join. You can enter more than one garment. So for my KALs, you can enter as many garments as you like. For Andrew's KALs, to enter, to start with, you can't have done a garment before. But if you've done your first garment in this KALs, and you put in the finished objects thread and you write in first garment, you can enter your second garment and there's time to do so. So what I thought, you've knitted a garment for yourself, knit a garment for your partner, so your twins.
Oh, we'll get onto that too. We can discuss that further.
Yes, we will. Okay, so there's plenty of time to do so. And then you will have double the chance of winning a prize.
Yeah, but the real news today, to move things along, is we had an idea that what we would do, it's a long KALs, okay, with the final date being the end of October. What we thought was we would do a bit of an interim session, and what we want to do there is we are inviting you to send us a 20-second selfie video of where you can introduce yourself. So you say, you know, you can say your name, your Ravelry name if you want to do that. Tell us what pattern you're doing, what wool you're doing maybe, and some comment on your project, how it's going,
and
what
your experience is. And put your half-finished garment on. So if it's top-down, it can be here hanging down. If it's bottom-up, you can slip it over your hips and say, here I am. If you haven't started yet, just get your bundle of wool and say, look at my great yarn choice and this is my pattern. Yeah. We just wanted to stay at 20 seconds and then we're going to make a collage to celebrate your wonderful knitting and to encourage you. And so there's a cutoff date for that and that's the end of August. So the 31st of August, you have to get your 20-second selfie footage to us by. And then the next episode, we will make a little interim selfie collage of your wonderful.
So we'll have a special segment.
Special segment to feature you. We're going to do it again at the end of October. So, and this time you'll have your finished garment completed and you'll be wearing it and you say, here I am, don't I look great, in 20 seconds. And then we'll do another collage. And that's a great way to showcase your wonderful, beautiful knitting. We're both very excited about that.
Yeah, and we're really taking advantage of the fact that we're an intimate group here.
You'll all be knitting television stars.
That's right. It's the launch of your international television career. The instructions on how to do that we'll put in the threads. So if you think in Ravelry, you go to the group and you'll find the thread for your KALs, whether it's the first garment or the Fair Isle KALs. Up the top, we'll have, you know, where we've got the instructions, what we expect for the KALs, we'll have the instructions on to how to submit your video and what we expect in there. And it should be really fun.
I'm really excited about it, so do it, please.
Yeah. I think that's it.
Okay, good. So we're up to our Knitters of the World segment, so enjoy it.
My name is Ginger Mitchell, and I live in Frankfurt, Germany. I'm originally from the U.S. I grew up in a state called Vermont, which is in the Northeast in New England. I have been knitting seriously for the last 6 years. I was taught the basic knit and purl stitches by my mother as a child, and then I picked it up as an adult about 6 years ago. In 2010, I was in Vermont over the winter. I was looking for a job and I had a lot of time on my hands. It was very cold and snowy and I thought, you know what? I don't have a hat. Why don't I, for fun, just try knitting myself a winter hat? And I found a pattern, taught myself how to knit in the round on YouTube, and I would say the rest is history. I've been totally obsessed with knitting since then. And it's been a wonderful hobby for me. I try to get as much knitting in as I can, whether it's traveling on the train or flying somewhere. I can also knit while watching TV or reading a book. So it's been a wonderful addition to my life, and I've really enjoyed growing my skills, trying to knit as many different types of things as possible, as well as the chance to meet wonderful knitters from all over the world. I love knitting all different types of projects, whether it's color work or lace or cables. If you name it, I've probably knitted something like it at some point. I'm lucky enough to live in Germany, where I have easy access to my favorite brand of yarn, which is Wollmeise. I think that the dyer has a wonderful range of beautiful colors that complement each other very nicely. So I'll just go through now and show you a couple of examples of projects that I've finished. This is a sweater that I knitted in a DK weight yarn. The pattern is called Marius, and it's a pattern from Norway. And I love the contrast. The simple blue, white, and red are very striking. And I think the pattern combination around the yoke is really interesting. And I would say this is probably one of my favorite sweaters that I've knit. This is another colorwork sweater that I knitted. It is also from Wollmeise DK. This is my holiday jumper. I thought the reindeer were really cute, and it just has a completely overall patterned look. And it's really fun, and I always wear it to my office holiday party since it's perfect for that. I also enjoy knitting socks, especially as gifts for friends or family. This is the Calendula cable sock pattern, which is on Ravelry and it's free. I love trying to get a striping effect, especially if I use a multi-colored yarn. So this ended up just being really fun with the cable detail. It was interesting. And I also used the fish lips kiss heel for the sock, which is the new heel that I've been trying out. And I've been really happy with the results. I find that it fits quite well, fits my feet quite well, and doesn't have any gaps around the arch, which is something that I had struggled with in the past. I usually have several different projects going at the same time. So this is a cable sweater pattern that I'm currently working on. I have the front and the back finished. I love the springiness of the yarn and the definition you get in the cables. This is also Wollmeise DK. And I have to knit the sleeves and seam it up. I'm in the process as well to convert the pattern from sort of a boxy sort of 80s design to a set in sleeve. So that's one of the things that I'm working on. We'll see how it goes. This is a lace stole that I finished, and while the pattern was just sort of this leaf pattern, it was really fun to knit, and I loved the sort of effect, the wonderful green. I hope you can see how vibrant it is coming across in the video. And it's a wonderful stole to wear inside in the office if it's cold. I don't know about you, but my office is always freezing. And you can wear it sort of to an elegant night out. And then in the winter, when it gets cold, you can kind of wrap it up around your neck and also stay warm when you're outside. I also recently finished a project that was very new to me. It was the first time that I had ever done beads. So this is the Amelie shawl, which is also available on Ravelry. And it has a really interesting construction. You actually start in the middle and you knit in the round for a while, and then you knit these sort of center leaf spines. Then you go back and start knitting in the round again, and you knit the rest of the shawl. So I really enjoyed this project because it had a lot of different techniques that I had never done before, especially the beading, as well as the picot, the sort of crochet edge for the bind off, which I had also never done before. And I was really proud of finishing this. It was the first time that I had used beads. And the funny thing is that I finished it and I blocked it and I didn't have enough pins. So I still have to re-block the other half, which is why I'm not showing you that part. I've also knitted quite a few round lace shawls, which I ended up using as decor in my house because I found that the shape for me was quite awkward to wear. I didn't like sort of wearing it just draped over my shoulders. And then as a scarf, it was not long enough on the sides. And then I came up with the idea of, hey, you know, you've knitted all these shawls. Why don't you use them in your house? So this is the Shipwreck Shawl, which is a free pattern from Knitty. And it has also an interesting construction. You start in the middle and you knit the pattern, and then you start knitting this sort of mesh lace section with progressively larger and larger needles. So you end up at the end with this kind of wonderful ruffled edge that looks a lot like a fishnet. And it also uses pre-strung beads. So that was one thing that I had also never done before. You string all the beads on the yarn in advance, and then you continue to knit with them. So it was a bit of a challenge stringing all the yarn, the beads onto the yarn, and then I would try to push them ahead as far as possible. But you know, it took a really long time to get everything together, and in the end, I'm quite happy with it. And I think as a decor piece, it's an interesting piece in my home. I've gotten a lot of interested questions about it and compliments. So if you ever need any ideas for what to do with circular shawls after you've knitted them, here's one. So the current project that I'm working on is a pooling stole. And it's knitted with a very multicolored yarn, as you can see. This is a Wollmeise multicolored skein. And you try to line up the lines of dye when you untwist the skein and take a look at it. You line them up so that each row on the project is one round from the skein. So you can line up sort of the green. As you can see, I have the green, the blue, the purple, the pink, and so on. And you have to pay attention and make sure that your tension is correct and that you can adjust as you're knitting to make sure that the colors stay aligned over the course of the project.
Thank you, Ginger. I just want to say a little bit about how Ginger and I met. She had just knitted her Alice Darmore Henry VIII and in Wollmeise and had taken some photos and put it up on her project page and also showed photos of it in an Alice Darmore forum. And her version of it looked great. It was completely different to my version because she used Wollmeise in very strong, bright colours. And so I was drawn to that and I checked her out, looked at her page and saw that there was a little German flag there and right next to it was written Frankfurt. And I thought, oh my God, she lives here. That's so wonderful. And I, at that time, was putting on or hosting knitting parties reasonably regularly. So I would invite anybody I knew who knitted and they could invite their friends who knitted and they would come over and we would eat and drink and knit and be merry for about 4 hours. So I promptly invited Ginger to our next knitting party and she very kindly came. And that's how we got to know her.
Yep. We're going to move on to talking about my hiking jacket, which is the project that I'm doing for my KALs, my first garment KALs. So maybe just as background, this is actually the jacket that I'm aiming to replace with what I'm going to make. This is just a standard hiking fleece hiking jacket. I wear it. I love it. I wear it when we go walking in Germany in the woods in winter. It's also something that gets a lot of use when we take our holidays in Snowdonia National Park, which we do these days. And it's a pretty standard sort of jacket. It's got set-in sleeves. It's quite fitted. It does have pockets. It's got a zip, which is really good for me because when you're walking, you've got a backpack on, you get warm when you get going, so you can undo it and then you can close it up again when you stop. It's not taking things on and off, which can be really hard. I did want to do it in a rough, sort of quite raw wool, which is just a sort of environmental thing, and it's just something I like. And the other thing that sort of came up, and it was actually Madeline, our daughter, who mentioned that, was these jackets here. It's a fleecy jacket, and you can feel they wear out. And essentially what that is it's all the synthetic material just dissolves, crumbles away. And you end up with these particles of stuff which get into the water. And, you know, and I personally think this plastic thing is one of the issues that's going to have to be dealt with pretty seriously soon. And, you know, moving away from synthetic garments like this, which just turn into rubbish, which never goes away, is one thing to do there. So yeah, that was my motivation. And I'm really, really excited about, I will still love this jacket and I'll still use it, but I'm really excited about making something myself that will replace that.
So let's show your great wool.
Yeah, so the wool that we've got. Whoops.
So this wool, which we won't say too much about because you'll learn more about it in the upcoming interview, is 50% Hebridean and 50% alpaca. It's a DK weight and it's undyed, so it's its natural shade.
Yeah, and I think it's a gentle wash, so there's still a bit of lanolin in there, which is nice. It makes it a little bit better water resistant. Yeah, it was what I was after.
And it's going to knit up into a really nice fabric, which is great for an outdoor garment. And yeah. So you've been working on a swatch, which is super exciting. We're going to, so the main garment is mainly going to be in this grey colour, but we did want to add some accent colour. So he's been swatching in the main colour and adding this accent colour. And if you hold this, I'll explain this swatch. So he started off with a bigger needle, and then every garter stitch row is when we thought, oh, that is going to be too loose a fabric, so we need to go down a size, and so that's down a size. To me, I thought that's still too open a fabric, because you've got to imagine when you're out hiking in the highlands and the wind's roaring through you, you still want a fabric that's a little bit tighter, a bit more jacket-like. So we kept going down needle sizes. Finally, we're at the needle size and the gauge that we want. And then we've got this contrast colour. And do you want to talk about that?
The needle size here is a 3.
Yeah, 3 millimetre. Yeah. Yeah. And this is a hemp tweed by Rowan, and it is 75% wool and 25% hemp. So it's actually a bit softer, but that's fine, because I'll show you in a minute what we're going to be using it for. But what we loved about it is it has this tweedy, it's got these white flecks in it, just like the natural shade has got white flecks in it as well. So I think it really works beautifully. So how are we coming up with ideas? Andrew wanted to base it on his hiking jacket. And then in episode 7, we saw Stephen Self show one of his jumpers that he'd knitted for himself, which was a dark blue jumper with a peekaboo hem of a light blue contrast colour. And that was on the cuffs and on the hem. And we both thought that looked really cool. So if that's your sleeve, okay, you'd see that you've got a contrast colour underneath. So we're going to do that on the cuffs, on the band, and on the inside of the collar. So on his collar that stands there like this, the inside of it is going to be this contrast colour. And if you want to bring the hiking jacket.
Yeah.
The other thing that Andrew thought he'd like, a little panel of contrasting colour down here. And so I thought, well, let's just, you know, you can see it easily on this jacket. It's a set-in sleeve. So this is the side seam, and then you've got your decrease here shaping. So if you start off with the panel in the contrast colour and then you decrease it, it naturally has a nice shape around like that. So we're going to do this colour in panels here, in the cuff and in the collar and underneath. And this is a great technique because Stephen followed a pattern by Elizabeth Zimmerman, and that was knitted in the round. And what you do is you start off in your contrast colour. So you cast on in your contrast colour. You knit not as much as this, maybe half as much. So maybe 8 rows or an inch and a half. And then you continue on in your normal colour. And then you turn it around and you make it into a hem. And how you do that is you knit one stitch together with one loop of the cast on edge. And you do that right across the row. And what that is effectively doing is sewing it in place for you. Okay, and that is a really obvious thing to do in the round, and I think that's great. And I was thinking for a while, can I translate that into pieces? Because we wanted to do pieces.
Yeah.
Why do we
want to do pieces? We want to do pieces because this is a big project for me. Okay, so far I've done one pair of socks completed, a hat completed, and 2/3 of a pair of socks. And so this is bigger than anything I've done. So for me, breaking it down into smaller bits makes it much easier to handle. And I'm going to have a small party at the end of each bit, particularly the back, which is where I'm starting apparently. The other thing I'm learning and listening to Andrea and learning all about why to do things in pieces is I think it gives you a better fit. I think we can, you know, get the fit more accurate, more simply.
I don't know about a better fit.
I mean, it lets us do the set in sleeves.
On such a simple garment, but yeah. No.
Can you set in sleeves in the round?
Yeah. You just do it in the round to here.
I haven't been paying attention at all.
You do it in the round to the here, and then you'd work it in pieces, the top part and the back part, and then you'd sew up, or you'd do a Kitchener stitch across here or graft it together, and then you'd pick up around here. But that's not my preferred way of method. But it is really good on a jacket because it gives you extra...
Gives you structure.
Structure.
Yeah, it makes it a bit more solid, which is not a bad thing. You don't want it being sloppy.
Yeah, so it's going to give it a nice structure down here, across here and around here for a wearing jacket, a practical wearing jacket.
Yeah.
So I wanted to figure out, can we do this in pieces? And I had a look in my James Norbury, the Penguin Knitting Book, which has arrived since the previous episode. And just in case you haven't seen the previous episode, James Norbury was the single most influencing designer or knitting character on British knitting on the 25 years directly after the Second World War. He was the director of Patons and Baldwin. And he had his own BBC television knitting show. Amazing guy. We feature him in the previous episode, and it's a fun episode to watch if you haven't seen it. Anyway, this book came, and he has some great, amazing designs in here. And on this page, you may not see it, but there are four very dapper-looking gentlemen in their Aran sweaters, waistcoats. Oh, not four. There's one lady here. And he has got an example of a man's continental slipover, which is kind of what it's exactly what I was thinking for Andrew. So he does this peekaboo. He doesn't do it in a contrasting colour, but he does this tucked under hem. And he does it with seaming. So he's given me a lot of confidence. I think definitely I can do it. So, yeah. But what he has done, which is very interesting, is that instead of starting in stocking stitch and continuing in your main colour, he starts in a 1x1 rib. So you start off at the beginning with a 1x1 rib, and then you continue in stocking stitch, and then you turn it around and make your hem. And we're thinking, why would he do that? And I think it's a great construction idea because a 1x1 rib is elastic and the inside circumference is going to be slightly smaller than the outside circumference, so it fits nicely that way. And if anything, it's got negative ease, a rib has, so it would sort of just hold it a bit firmer and good. So we'll probably incorporate that as well.
Yep. So we're kind of making up the pattern a little bit ourselves, but we did get a lot of inspiration, or Andrea, you got a lot of inspiration from this book here. All right, it's called Knits Men Want. It's written by Bruce Weinstein, who's actually written a lot of books on cooking. He has done some craftsy courses on knitting, and I think he's got one other book on knitting. Interesting here, the photographer for this book is Jared Flood, right? And Jared Flood is the founder and creative director of Brooklyn Tweed. Jared Flood actually started off his sort of creative career doing a master's of...
Fine art,
yes, in New York. And he was focusing on photography and drawing and more visual arts. And that's sort of how he moved into knitting, was that he did photographs, and I think he had a blog of his photographs, and he became very popular for the work that he did.
On knitting.
Showing male knitting work.
Yeah.
And then he moved into designing himself. Anyway, in this book, he's the photographer, so I think that's a bit of,
interesting,
bit of pedigree
there. Bruce spent a lot of time doing knitting courses and teaching knitting classes, and his main... customers or students were women, and he would constantly hear woe stories or stories of woe of how they had tried to knit for the men in their life and it had turned out to be a major failure. And so he tried to counteract that with this book by writing a book on... He has 10 basic rules which he uses as a guideline. So if you follow these rules, you should have more success knitting for your bloke.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think it's a really good basic premise for a book, you know, because it's an unfortunate thing when you've got somebody who's, you're a knitter and enthusiastic about it and you want to do something really nice for your husband or whoever, your special man, and you put in a whole lot of work and it doesn't work and the guy doesn't want to wear it, or he's trying to wear it and not happy about it, or, you know...
Wears it once to please and then it's in the back of the wardrobe.
There's a lot of scope for upsetness there. So he's trying to deal with that situation. I think it's a really good thing to do. And the knits in here, the patterns in here, they're basic things like jumpers and cardigan and a hat and gloves and scarf.
Yeah.
And so I think relatively simple thing. His approach is to he helps you through doing the measurements. So how do you have to measure up the guy to see how it fits? It's not done for any specific wool, so you do a swatch.
Of the yarn, so you pick the yarn that you want to use and knit a gauge.
Yeah, so you do your gauge swatch, and then he says, right, if your gauge is like this and you're doing this size, then this is what the pattern looks like. So it's really flexible, and I think, you know, fit is really important, and he goes into a lot of detail there. As Andrea mentioned, he's got sort of rules about how to do projects that will work for men. And that's where it sort of gets a little bit interesting. I've written down some of the... Each chapter has a topic, and some of these topics are men resist change, men are babies, and men are oblivious, all right? And that's sort of referring to the fact that saying men don't really care what they wear. Men are babies is about they don't like things scratchy or anything.
But you're different. Difficult. You like good scratchy
wool. Well, this is the thing. Men resist change. Some of these rules don't always apply.
And they're a little bit cliched. They remind me of the book Men Are From Mars and Women Are From Venus. So it's got those generalizations. But surprisingly enough, there are always some things which are pretty true.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. Some of it is just shockingly accurate from my perspective. In our earlier podcasts, you can see Andrea's made me some jumpers which I consider absolutely stunning. I love them. They fit me perfectly. The colours are all right. They're stylish, you know, and they're really intricate. They're special things, okay? One of his chapters is called Men Hate Fittings, right? And even in this situation when I know I'm going to get this jumper, which I'll absolutely love, and it's going to be super... I really hate doing the fitting.
He still hates it. I said, come on, take your clothes off.
I've got to
do a measurement.
Stand here and hold your arms up here. You know, like, oh, God. So what does he say here? He's got tips to counteract that. Right? Tell him when you start the project that you're going to need him to try on the garment 3 times.
Yes. Right? Prepare them.
Andrea's doing, I don't know, 100 hours work on this, but you have to get a special agreement that I'm going to stand still or stand with my arms in the air for about 10 minutes 3 times, okay? So set the expectation right. Never ask him while he's watching telly, reading the paper, or engaged in some other important activity, you know? And then the third one is the one I really like. Bribe him. If you're dealing with a romantic partner, tell him you'll take something off for every piece he puts on. I think that's, you know, so there's some really...
That's something that you definitely go for.
Really good points, yeah. But then Yeah, looking, I mean, it's got these stereotypes and they're funny, but
some of them are valuable. True. I mean, he talks a lot about typical complaints men have, and that is that wool is too hot, or they don't want to wear something that's too hot. So he goes into other good materials that you could use, cotton, hemp, whatever, so other alternatives. He talks about not making something too much of a work of art. They just want something that's good and practical and simple that they can wear all the same.
Yeah. I mean, there is that the one story in here where the writer of the book was out with a woman who's knitting something for her husband, and it's something very extravagant, and and he says, colourful. You're knitting that for Jack, yeah, for your husband. And she says, yeah, I'm doing this for Jack. And he says, try it on, you know.
See if it fits you.
Yeah, try it on. And she puts on this fancy jumper that she's knitting, and he writes here how he is very relieved to see that it did. They wore the same size, and this jumper was actually going to fit her, because
she'd
it was clear
end up wearing
that
it.
Yeah, if anyone was going to wear this jumper, it was going to be her and not him, so not her husband. So, yeah.
Jack hasn't made an appearance for a few episodes, and he's just been to the hairdresser, and he's looking so dapper. So we thought we should show him off. Hey, beautiful boy.
Yeah.
They make his hair so fluffy and gorgeous. But we have got enough of this wool that we're going to do father and son jumpers.
Oh, right.
So Jack is going to have his own little coat in this wool to go with Andrew, hiking coat.
Yeah, okay. That does go back to our book where it says never, ever make matching garments for your husband and your child or pet.
Really?
Yes, something like that.
I'm just as excited as Andrew is about his jacket. So that's going to be fun.
Yeah.
And I love the idea of the accent colour.
Yeah, so we're aiming for the end of October.
Yes, Andrew may fail his KALs, but never mind.
Yeah.
But this leads us on to the fantastic interview that we've got waiting for you. So stick in there, hang in there, get yourself a drink. I had so much fun doing this interview, and I learned so much myself, because it's in an area that I really was completely new to, conservation grazing. I didn't even know existed, knew nothing about it, and I certainly don't know much about sheep breeds, and that was really interesting for me to find out. It's a great interview that I'm doing with the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust, and there's some really good footage of shearing that they've done, which they're just in the previous month. So hang in there. I think you're going to find it very entertaining and informative. So we're going to say goodbye to you now, and thank you so much for spending time with us and watching. Again, if you've enjoyed this, please subscribe.
Yeah, we'll be back in 2 weeks. Leave your comments. We're on Instagram as Fruity Knitting and Ravelry as Fruity Knitting. And there is fruityknitting.com.
Yes.
Yep. Alrighty, and enjoy the interview. We'll see you in 2 weeks.
Yes. Welcome to the Fruity Knitting Podcast. A few weeks back, I received a short introduction message from the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust, letting me know that they have knitting yarns and woolen products for sale. Because I'm interested in environmental protection, I naturally became quite curious about why a wildlife trust would be selling knitting yarns. So I had a look at their website and came across the concept of conservation grazing, which was new to me. The Yorkshire Wildlife Trust has a 500-strong conservation grazing flock of Hebridean and Shirolla sheep, but they've only very recently decided to use the fleece from their flock to produce knitting yarns and woolen products, which they then sell to help continue the funding of the Wildlife Trust. And Andrew went ahead and bought himself a jumper's worth of their undyed DK weight yarn. So we're both very interested in finding out more about conservation grazing and the production process of this yarn. So today I'm speaking to Pete Batchelor, the volunteer financial advisor, and Ellen Fairbank, the farm and grazing manager for the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust. So let's find out how our knitting can support nature conservation in Yorkshire. Welcome, Pete and Ellen, and thank you both for being on the podcast.
Hi.
Hi, Andrew.
So let's start with a brief description of who or what the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust is and what the main goals are.
So Yorkshire Wildlife Trust is a charity. It's one of 46 wildlife trusts in the UK. Our objectives are to promote nature conservation very much on a local scale, and we do this through land management of nature reserves and education of school groups and university students. We manage over 100 nature reserves. We've got 2,400 hectares of land that we manage in Yorkshire. And we've also got 40,000 members. We're always looking for more. These members are all people who are keen to support nature conservation in Yorkshire.
The Wildlife Trust uses livestock on the reserves to help look after the natural habitats. But how exactly does conservation grazing help the various species of animal and plant wildlife in the Yorkshire area?
Right, conservation grazing is a term that we use to describe using livestock to manage areas of grassland for the benefit of wildlife and create the correct habitats for wildlife. Using livestock has proved to be a much better option than cutting grass, because the livestock selectively graze. They create uneven sward lengths, which is better for habitats for wildlife, such as breeding birds and voles and mice and insects. And so in general, that's a lot better method than cutting grass, which would be of a uniform height, which just wouldn't be suitable for wildlife. They also spread seeds on the seeds from the grasses and the flowers, attach themselves to the coats and the wools of the animals. They walk around, the seeds drop off, and then the animals sometimes press them in with their feet, so that it helps germination of the seeds. Quite often, if we have low stocking densities, breeding birds will breed on sites where we do have animals grazing, providing stocking densities are low. It works well. If we were cutting the grass, obviously it wouldn't be ideal for breeding birds, and the wildlife would just wander off in a different direction.
Yeah. Okay. So has conservation grazing become more important in recent years, or yeah? And if so, why? Can you explain that?
Yeah, it definitely has become important. 90% of the natural grasslands in the UK have disappeared or are declining over the last 20 years. That's usually because of the intensive grazing, which is used on intensive grasslands, or the other thing is arable cropping, growing corn. So there is definitely a decline in natural grasslands, so conservation grazing is very important to provide them habitats for wildlife.
Okay. So, and that's just because of an increase of different agricultural practices in recent times, is that right?
Yeah,
it is. Okay. So in the past, farmers were doing it more like what you're doing, is that right?
I would say so. When there was less pressure on the farmers, they had a different way of farming. Machines were less, not as many herbicides were used, and cropping was less intensive. So yeah, we're really farming almost in an old traditional way.
So what kinds of livestock are suitable for conservation grazing? Because I've heard not just sheep are being used, but other livestock. So can you tell us about that?
Yeah, we use sheep and cattle for conservation grazing. We also use ponies as well. Goats can be used, so there's many species. Of all the species which are used, usually the primitive ones are the hardier breeds. They prefer to eat less. They prefer to eat scrub and plants which have less feed value, and they thrive very, very well on those plants that don't have as much feed value in them, whereas a commercial animal just wouldn't do very well. It would probably go very thin and not thrive at all.
Okay. So I'd like to talk about your sheep, because you've got Hebridean and I'm saying this wrong, Charolais, or just correct me, how do you say it?
Yeah, they're actually Charolais.
Okay.
Charolais sheep are not a primitive breed. We just run some Charolais alongside of our Hebridean flock. We mainly have Hebridean sheep, which are a small, black, very primitive sheep. They're very hardy. They survive very well in cold conditions, and they survive very well on very poor quality vegetation. So they're an ideal sheep to use for conservation grazing.
That's the Hebridean, isn't it?
It is,
and the Charolais, how are they particularly suited in for the Yorkshire landscape?
The reason we actually keep Charolais sheep is we actually just run a few of them alongside our Hebridean sheep to produce a really good quality white wool, which is what we blend with our wool products. So that's our only real reason for keeping the Charolais sheep.
Okay.
We have a flock of around 500 sheep, depending on the time of year. 135 of them are breeding females, which we breed from. The rest of the flock are what we call our flying flock, which travel out around reserves at different times of year, grazing. They can be in groups of between 10 or 200, depending on the size of the reserve.
So for a while, the shorn fleece from your sheep was only being used as compost. And I've actually heard that this is quite often the case, even worldwide, for sheep, for the fleece of sheep that are only bred for meat. So at what point did you decide to start making woolen products from your fleece?
So it was about 3 years ago. One of the trust's volunteers, Dagna Linton, who lives in York, and Paul Crooks, who's a member of the trust, is also a spinner. They identified that the trust wasn't making the best use of its wool, and between them came up with a plan on how we could use some of that wool to generate funds for the charity. And between them, pretty much on their own, they created this end-to-end process, which going from shearing to processing through to producing wool products. And that's been done voluntarily, and it's fabulous for the trust.
So you've got Hebridean and Charolais fleeces. What are the particular characteristics or qualities of these fleeces?
Yes, the Hebridean fleece is a black or dark brown fleece. It can vary in colour from the outside of the fleece to the inside, actually. And whilst the Charolais is a thick white fleece. And these fleeces, then when they come off the sheeps, they can be pretty knotted. They can potentially be dirty through shearing. So we put them through a quality control process at the shearing time. And then they get assessed again at the spinning time as well by our spinner, who Paul Crooks. The fleeces themselves, they can be soft in places and they can be quite coarse in others. Dagna and Paul felt that whilst we could just produce a 100% Hebridean or 100% Charolais knitting yarn, for instance, they actually felt it'd be better to mix it with an alpaca, which we don't have any alpaca. We quite fortuitously, when we started to say, well, how could we source some of that, found out that one of the trustees of the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust actually used to keep alpaca in Yorkshire, in Barnsley, South Yorkshire. And when we mentioned it to her, she said, oh, I never used any of the wool. I just put it in the loft, keeping a house warm. And she's donated a very large supply of alpaca wool to us. So that's allowed us to create a mix, which is slightly, it's a softer wool than it would have been if we'd just gone 100% Hebridean.
Yeah.
And it's been really popular to have, you know, have that slightly softer, nicer to touch yarn.
Yeah. Okay. So you've got an annual shearing plan now. So did you have to change your shearing methods when you decided to use the fleece for wool products? So before it was just for compost, and now it's for woolen products. What had to change there?
What we've done is we've changed shearer now, so that we can get better quality shear and a better quality fleece produced at shearing time. So we now use a really nice man called Michael Churchhouse, who's from New Zealand. He's actually based in Bedfordshire, so he travels all the way up to Yorkshire to shear our sheep. We shear in June, and because our sheep are spread all the way over Yorkshire, we gather them up and shear at three locations through Yorkshire, which one would be at Spurn Point, the other at Staveley Nature Reserve, and the other at our farm near Pickering in North Yorkshire. So it's quite a logistical effort, shearing. But now that we've changed shearer, the quality of shear produced is really good. He uses electric clippers to do some of them, but he also uses traditional methods with what they call blade clipping, just with the hand shears as well, and he does some like that. So
it's probably a lot more friendly on the sheep too if he's doing hand clipping as well. Is that correct? Or
it is. The sheep, the hand clipping is very quiet, very calm, no noise, and the sheep are very relaxed. It's great.
Lovely, lying on their backs there. Okay, so it's July now. So you've just done a shearing session for this year. How did that go?
Yeah, very successful. We had really good quality wool this year. We think about 85% of all our fleeces are usable for wool, which is very, very good. When we first started off a few years ago trying to produce the wool for this particular reason, we only had 35% that was suitable for this type of wool production. So we're very happy this year.
So is that increase due purely because you've changed the shearer, or is it also anything to do with the way you've managed the flock during the year?
It's a little bit of both, because the shearer has made a massive difference. The other thing is we're very keen to control certain weeds which are on the reserves now. There's certain weeds that get tangled up in the wool, and then you can't get them out, so that ruins the fleece. So we're very, very careful to control them weeds on specific sites now.
Okay, so let's talk about the whole production process of the wool products. Because you're a wildlife trust, your environmental footprint and working organically is going to be high on your agenda. So can you just tell us the whole process from shearing to your end products? And yeah, so what do you do and how do you try to keep it organic and environmentally friendly?
Sure. So we, as you say, we want to keep it as simple as process as possible. We want to keep it the miles that the wool travels at any stage as short a distance as possible to keep it environmentally friendly. So the wool, once we've been through the shearing, goes to the spinner, which is Paul Crooks at the Halifax Spinning Mill. They're based about 20 miles from York. So all the wool goes there, and then the wool will be gently washed using steam and water. So by doing that, we're not using any chemicals in that washing process. And then it retains a little bit of the lanolin in the wool as well, albeit having the steam does take some of that away. And then we try to keep it, we don't dye, so it's 100% natural colours. So the colour will come through from both either the Hebridean or the Charolais, or depending on what alpaca we've mixed into it as well. And so today we've had a few nice shades which we've been able to create. So when it gets to the spinner, the wool, all the wool spun at the spinner, some of it will be spun into knitting yarn. Whilst some of it will also be spun as to potentially make manufactured products. The knitting yarns, we then also have some of those, we have a group of volunteer knitters who take some of that and turn it into products such as hats, scarves, gloves, which then we can sell as well. And then the manufactured products, again, it moves on to a manufacturer. We've looked to source a manufacturer as close as we can to Yorkshire. It's in the Yorkshire Dales National Park, at Farfield Mill. So there's not much movement for the wool at all. We can pretty much call it all Yorkshire product, which is great, and that's one of our real aims.
What products are you actually currently producing? Because you've got woven products as well, haven't you?
To date we've produced three knitting yarns. So we actually produced an Arran knitting yarn. It was the slightly darker one here you can see on in front of us. It was made with Hebridean wool 80%, and then we mixed in 20% of some alpaca into that. Since then, we've created a couple of DK knitting yarns. We've made one with the Hebridean here in the middle, and then one with the Charolais, and again they've been mixed in with some alpaca, and so we've got those three different colours. And as I said, some of those then get knitted into product by our fabulous volunteers. Here's an example of one of the hats they've produced for us, which we can then sell. And I have to say, I've got one myself, and it's absolutely fantastic. Now, we're never going to make a large business out of that because there's only so many they can knit, but it's great. It all helps with fundraising, and those have been really popular. And then we've also been looking at what bespoke weaved products we can have produced. As I said, trying to keep it within Yorkshire. And here we've got, this is one of the blankets we've had produced. This was made with the Hebridean. With a little bit of, it's got some white straps on there from the Charolais, and these are bespoke. We've only had 100 of these made, so these are something which will make a fabulous Christmas present for someone. So we sell all these via our web shop and via our Etsy shop. And we also sell them. We've got a couple of outlets where we sell them at nature reserves, where we've got small shops as well.
And do you have plans for future products or different things than what you've developed so far?
We do. So we just completed the shearing for this year, and the plan is to add two colours to the range. So we don't actually have any of the Aran left, so we're going to go for something of a similar colour, a darker Hebridean chocolatey colour, and then we're also going to look at we're going to also have another lighter shade as well, which should be using the Charolais. So those should be available probably in the next month or two. And then we're considering options for bespoke products. We've obviously got the lovely blankets. We're considering, you know, possibilities around, you know, could we go with rugs or even create a Yorkshire tweed? I think these are all things which are still in the pipeline and still deciding what the best thing to do is.
A Yorkshire tweed sounds great. I love a tweed. And what about your flock? Have you got any plans to grow the flock or introduce different breeds or...?
We've a number of other nature reserves that we'd love to potentially implement conservation grazing on, or we've got some sites which we use third-party graziers on because we just don't have the resource to do it ourselves. So I think at some point we may increase the size of the flock to do that if we can afford to do it. It's also very likely we'll add new nature reserves at some stage, which each one we take on will require managing in some way. So if that is best done with conservation grazing, again, we would look to possibly grow the flock. We've talked about if we were to take on, there are some habitats in Yorkshire, some moorland habitats, where our current flock would probably get lost because of the colour, so we might need to take on at some stage. So. It's also possible we may take on another farm at some stage in the future. There's all sorts of possibilities.
Okay. So, Ellen, your job is as a grazing and farming manager. Do you go out and check on the sheep, and is that part of your job?
It is. I'm responsible for the health and welfare of all the sheep and the cattle that we have. We have the Hebridean sheep, Highland cattle, White Park cattle, and be short on cattle, so there's quite a lot to get round. But we don't look after the livestock on a daily basis that are on the reserves. We use an army of volunteer livestock checkers that give up their time to go out and check the livestock for us on a daily basis. Without those volunteer livestock checkers, we wouldn't be able to carry out this conservation project that we do, because I just wouldn't be able to travel the large distances every day to check the livestock. So I do check the livestock, but not on a daily basis on all the reserves.
Be a pretty cool job, I reckon, getting out there and see, because you'll be looking at did you say also goats? You've got ponies, cattle, Did you say goats as well?
No, we don't use goats. We don't use goats, but I do believe that they are used in other areas for conservation grazing, but we've not ventured into goats yet.
Okay. So what are some simple and immediate ways that people can support the Wildlife Association if they want to?
And we're a membership organisation, so we're always seeking new members, and people can sign up simply and easily as a member on our website. It starts from as little as £2.75 a month, which we love to grow our membership in Yorkshire. You can join the other wildlife trusts in a similar way as well. The wildlife trusts also have hundreds of volunteering opportunities again across the UK. So we're always looking for new volunteers. Some might even be able to help with the grazing project. And then, of course, you can support the conservation grazing project as well through purchasing our wool products. As I said, they're available for sale on our Etsy shop, Yorkshire Wildlife, and also on our Yorkshire Wildlife Trust website. Those are three great ways people can help support us.
I think it's great, this changing it so that you can use the fleece into yarn products. And since that, have you thought about doing a template or something that perhaps other wildlife trusts around the world who might be interested in doing this could perhaps look at you as an example? Or did you do that by looking at somebody else as an example?
It's commonly that one wildlife trust will take the lead, and then everyone else will see what they're doing, and then follow suit. So I think I know one or two of the other wildlife trusts had already started to look at creating the knitting yarns, and so there's a couple out there. But I think it's something that there's no reason all 46 should be doing at some stage in the coming years.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you both so much for coming onto the podcast, and thank you so much for all your volunteer work in helping the environment. And it's really great to hear stories like this. So, yeah, thanks a lot for coming and showing your great products, and we really look forward to knitting it up into jumpers and exploring how it goes.
Well, thanks for having us.
Thank you.
And we do look forward to seeing the finished product as well at some point.
We'll show you. Okay, so we'll say goodbye now.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.